what that means for us as a congregation and what it means to be able to come together and praise. And I know with a smaller audience, it sometimes feels like maybe we might stand out more, so we participate less. But one of the things that we do when we bring worship, and sorry, I've also been told that I don't speak into the mic loud enough for people to hear. So if you can't hear me because I'm too quiet, give me a thumbs up. Sorry, folks. I think one of the things we do when we bring worship is we're bringing worth that we can offer God, regardless of if we have a good voice. Because sometimes when we sacrifice ourselves, if we don't have a great voice, or the singing of praise to God, we can get ourselves into an opportunity to present that worth to God. And so as I read this morning, blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. I would love it if we could come to worship today without those barriers. I know when I read that, scoffers stood out to me. And again, if I'm feeling a personal conviction about scoffing, it's because for the last 4 months, over and over and over again, the news tells me this, it tells me that. What I would love is if we could just step out of that today. So if you're here today and you're thinking about coronavirus, I would just love it if you would stand with me in worship. If you're here and you're thinking about the protests in the States, I would love it if you would rather turn your mind towards Jesus and just focus on what he has to offer you today through this service. So if you would stand with me, take that moment and that change of posture and recognize that you're letting go of what you walked in here with and you're standing just to bring praise and glory to God.
Was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It wasn't mine too, till I met you. Breathing.
if you feel like it, I would really love it if you guys could just, we're going to try and do this as best we can as a hoedown medley. It's Leaning on the Everlasting Arms. We're just going to tag on the end there, 'Tis So Sweet to Trust in Jesus.
Thank you.
Drive home that night, that guy crashed and died. And it prompted the guy who wrote it to become a crazy worship leader. And among that, he wrote this song in response to that accident. And attributed to this song as an altar call, there are millions of young men and women who their lives to Jesus just listening to this song. And I know you may not know this song from your youth, but it is an amazing thing to think that God God can take everything that we offer him, and he can return it for good, no matter the trouble. And so just as we sing this last chorus, I'd just like our instruments maybe to die off. We won't play anything else, but I just want us to sing as a congregation. Just as you're doing that, I just want you to imagine God in heaven just looking down on you and taking your praise and your worship and accepting it as an offering so sweet that smells so good to him that he would give his own son for us. In heaven, I hope that you hear our praise, Lord, and that it is as sweet and aroma as we can offer. Lord, I just pray that today, as we hear your word, Pastor David, Lord, that you would speak through to our hearts. God, that you would bring life transformation in this church, and God, even more than that, Lord, that you would find a way to ignite our spirits, our hearts, our souls, to just go out into this community for the lost, Lord, in a way that we've never done. God, that you would find a way to inspire us to action. God, just bless Dave as he brings this word. Just give total blessing to the hearts of this world. We ask in Jesus' precious, precious name.
So beautiful to know that God loves us. And those words, just sometimes I'll sing that song, or sometimes even this Saturday or the other night, I was just looking up at the skies and looking at the world and realizing that Jesus looked down on this world and he said, "For God so loved the world that he gave." That's how much he loves us. And that's pretty awesome. You know, we live in a strange, strange time. None of us expected this for 2020, and I've said this before, and you all have heard that statement a million times. But what's hit me with all the information out there, how do you know what's true? How do you know what's false? We have so much access to information. It's amazing how one place will say this about a subject, and another place will say this about a subject, and both are opposite of each other. And it's not just true of the virus, but politics, social issues, and pretty much every aspect of life. I mean, we are getting so much inundation with information. News, social media, internet, blogs, podcasts, newspapers, radio, television, and a million other different sources. And I don't know about you, but I just feel sometimes overwhelmed if you just listen to those things. And they all are saying, so many things. You can listen to one news outlet and listen to another and get a different point of view on the same story. You got conservative, you got liberal, you've got white, black, Republican, Democrat, Christian, non-Christian, liberal Christian, conservative Christian, and it's hard to tell what to listen to and what you should believe. Today I want to deal with a fundamental issue for all us humans. Not so much in this information about COVID-19 or whatever else is the topic of the day, but fundamentally, when it comes to life and the issues of life, who are we listening to? Whose voice are we listening to? Because honestly, almost every person on earth wants to know truth. They want to have a handle on it. They really do. That's why we read. That's why we look for information. Because we really do want to know the truth and land on that. We want to get direction and guidance for our life. People are looking for something and something to give them direction. And the issue is, whose voice are we listening to? as somewhere as a follower of Christ, and this is a really important thing, whose voice am I listening to? Because here's the thing. I've seen churches listen to the wrong voice. I've seen people in the church who've listened to the wrong voice. I've seen myself listen to the wrong voice. You know, I've seen churches where they've listened to the wrong voice and are more concerned about public image and more concerned about not having a scandal, that they've ignored abuse that's taken place in the church. And sexual abuse has continued, and hurt and pain, and hatred towards God comes out of that, because people say, if this is what God means and this is who God is, I don't want anything to do with it. I've seen followers of Christ make financial decisions based only on bottom line thinking, which is not always bad. I mean, I'm not saying you shouldn't have bottom line thinking, but they've taken God out of the picture and the miracles of what God could do, and about faith and trusting in God to do amazing things. I've seen followers of Christ make policy and directional decisions based on who they know or who somebody seems important. And sometimes decisions are made that are wrong in the church and wrong amongst Christians because of so-and-so and how they think this person is important, so I need to listen to them. And they never bring it to God. I've seen churches that have had so much selfishness and pride that people want their own way and their position, and there's no focus on Christ. And fighting and groups solidify amongst themselves over one issue, and division and disunity takes place. Again, spills out into the community, and the community looks on and says, this is the bride of Christ? I've seen churches focus on spiritual and emotional experiences and ignore the Word of God and go down a road that can rip a church apart. I've witnessed Christians who've dabbled in the occult, witchcraft, divination, palm reading, horoscopes, Ouija boards, seance, psychics, meditation, all to try to get an answer because I want to know truth. And they give the devil a foothold in their life. I've seen major decisions made based on logic and not prayer. And things are accomplished, but there's no power of God in it. Because we just did the right thing, but sometimes we miss out on what God could do. I've even seen churches more concerned about party politics. I know I'm stepping on toes here, maybe, I don't know. Where it seems like the political party is more important than their faith in Jesus. And they write people off, and they argue about situations and issues. You know, I wonder if what Paul meant when he wrote to the church, and he wrote about the end times, he said this, talking about the church, but talking about Christianity and talking about the world, they have a form of godliness. It's 2 Timothy 3:5. But they deny its power. They seem okay, but there's something wrong. Who have we listened to? Or are we even asking and then waiting for the answer? We really need to establish whose voice we're listening to, because there are really four voices that we listen to. We listen to our own voice and our own advice. We listen to other people's advice and opinions. And then there's these voices that are behind all the scenes, and this is the enemy, Satan, and the voice of God. Both our own voice and the voice of others can be easily influenced by the enemy, Satan, and hopefully by God. What does Jesus say about this? Jesus didn't mince words when he said who you should listen to, who you get your answers from. He said in John chapter 8, verse 31 and 32, and he was talking to a group of people, including the Pharisees, he said this, to the Jews who had believed him, Jesus said, if you hold to my teaching, you're really my disciples. Then he says this, you will know a truth. Now, he didn't say that. He said, you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Jesus wasn't saying there's many truths to God. You can just find it. Just go out there and look for it. You'll eventually discover it. No, he's saying, if you want to know the truth, if you want to know what's really true about life and how to live in this world today, you want to be free, listen to me. And I'm not pointing to me. I'm talking about Jesus. Jesus wasn't trying to win an argument with the debate or debate the Pharisees and saying, guys, I understand your point of view, and yeah, let me listen to your point of view. Jesus wasn't even saying that. He was saying, guys, no, this is the truth, my truth. You want to listen to me? You want to be free? Listen to me. Later on, just a few verses down, he says, another voice you might be listening to, and he specifically said this to the Pharisees. He said this, why is my language not clear to you? Why aren't you listening to me? I've been very plain about this. And he says this, the reason is, he's basically saying, is because you're unable to hear what I say. You belong to your father. And these are pretty strong words, the devil. And you want to carry out your father's desire? He was a murderer from the beginning, not holding to the truth. There's no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks his native language, for he is a liar and the father of lies. He's the originator of lies. He's the one that comes up with the lies. And every half-truth or partial truth is really from the enemy, because it's really not from God. He's the father of lies. He's the one that produces lies and untruth. God wants very much to speak into our lives, and he wants to set us free. And he doesn't want us to be bound in sin. And the devil wants to keep you bound and keep you in sin and will lie to do so. The fundamental truth is we can listen to God's voice or the opposite, which is the enemy, the devil. Now that seems strong, and none of us likes to think that we're ever listening to the devil. We hope we're hearing God's voice in everyday life, but the reality is, no matter what, if it's not God's truth, even if it's a half-truth, it's from the father of lies, the originator. You think about it. Now I know you may say, well, I mean, if it's not from the Bible, then it can't be true. Well, yeah, I mean, science around you, it's true. The sun, we revolve around the sun. Now, I know people think, and I hope there's none of you here, that we're this flat earth society, and, you know, that's not true. The earth is round. I just want to say that, okay? But that's truth, right? But that's still God's truth, because he put it there. He did all of that. So that's truth. Don't get me wrong. I'm not saying you can't get truth from some other source. But ultimately, that truth comes from God. But any half-truths, lies, schemes, they ultimately come from the devil, the enemy, who's trying to confuse us and to lie to us. How many times, listen, you know, we react when we listen to other voices. When we listen to our own voice, and the enemy knows how to push our buttons. How many of you guys have kids? How many know your kids can push your buttons? And I don't know if they ever intend to do that, but, you know, they just know how to push, right? They just know how to push. And I'm not saying your kids are the devil. Don't get me wrong here, okay? But the enemy loves to push our buttons, doesn't he? Now, I remember one particular situation I was in, and I was in charge of this ministry. And it wasn't really in our church. It was an outside ministry, and I was in charge of it. And I got this email, and it said, we are going to do this at such and such a time, and this was his ministry. And so I got a little bit offended, because I'm in charge, right? And so I went and wrote back to the guy, actually called him on the phone. I said, how dare you do this? And I may not use those words. I was probably a little nicer. And I just said, you know, I'm in charge, and you should have told me, and we should have been aware of this before you put that out. And he said, yeah, I'm really sorry. And he was really, you know, congenial about it, but I was still steamed. The problem is, I found out later that I did know about it, and it was really, he did everything right. Now, my pride wanted to say, well, I'm not talking to him again. I'm going to let him just sweat about it. But instead, I called him on the phone, and I said, hey, I'm really sorry. You know, you were right, and I should have done this, and da-da-da-da, and we restored it and everything like that. But here's the thing that taught me, and it's in a million different other cases. Arguments with my wife, and arguments with my kids, and arguments with people in the church, and all of those things. The enemy will use those moments to push our buttons, and to cause disunity, and to cause friction, and to cause offense. And it just, he does it all the time. And in those relationships, I guess I just really want us to understand how the enemy tries to manipulate things. There's a book, and many of you may have done this study, by John Bevere, called The Bait of Satan. How many of you have ever heard of that book? Great book. And in that book, it's basically, he say, the bait of Satan is offense. Well, you offended me. You offended me. And we live with that offense. And we go around and we're unforgiving, we're uncaring, we're rude to people. We react in a way that's unlike God. And we're listening to the lies of the enemy, the bait of Satan. Satan's like baiting us. You see what they did to you? See what they said to you? Look what they're doing. Isn't that offensive? I can't believe they did that to you. And he pokes the button, he pushes the buttons, and he pushes the buttons. And we're listening to the voice of the enemy instead of listening to the voice of God. And relationships are destroyed because how people respond to us or how they don't respond to us and how we think they should respond to us or what they did or they didn't do. And the enemy likes to push our buttons. And the question is, whose voice are we listening to? Whose voice are we listening to? I say all that to say this. We're all influenced, and we need to listen to different voices, and we listen to different voices, but we need, as Christ followers, to stop listening everywhere else and go to Jesus. David inquired of the Lord, and anytime he did not, he messed up. Jehoshaphat said this, "We don't know what to do, but our eyes are upon you, Lord." They understood that the voice that they needed to listen to was God, and he had the answers. So how do we hear from God? You know, over the years, I've had a lot of people tell me, you know, ask me this question. How do you hear the voice of God? How do you know the will of God? Because I think every single one of us wants to know the will of God. Well, maybe. So what does God say about this? Well, first of all, he says we need to give up. And this is a passage of scripture that I preached on a lot. And so, but we're just going to look at it in a fresh way here today. In Romans chapter 12, and I just think this is so foundational to this idea, because he specifically says, then you'll know the truth, you'll know the way, you'll know the will of God. In Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, it says this, "Therefore I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices." In other words, offer yourself up, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship. Worship is not just singing songs on Sunday morning. Worship is how you live. It's giving your life to Jesus, totally. He says this, don't conform any longer to the pattern of this world. He says, give up. We need to give up. If honestly we're going to hear the voice of God, we need to get in a place where we're willing and we have a surrendered heart. Lots of time we want to hear from God, but we're not willing to really hear and go for it. God sometimes actually will hold back his will, and maybe he won't even tell us what his will is because he knows we're not going to take it. He doesn't want to just give it out and say, here it is, because we're not even willing to seek it. We're just like, well, let me choose. I don't know. But God wants to give us his will. He wants to show us his way. He wants us to hear his voice. And what that means is that we've got to give up things. We've got to stop being conformed to the pattern of this world. I mean, the pattern of this world is a voice of offense, a voice of anger and unforgiveness sometimes. It's not always that, but it seems to be that sometimes. It's a crazy world we live in. I could get into specifics, but you know what? If I get into specifics, some of you will be mad at me, and some of you will think, yeah, that'll go, Pastor Dave, right? Because it's crazy out there, isn't it? You just turn on the news. It's a nut house. So whose voice do we listen to? We've got to stop conforming to the pattern of this world, being like everybody else. Instead, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. What that means is to give up. To give up means to be humbled. To humble yourself. Say, God, I don't know all the answers. I really don't. It means to obey. It means to risk for Jesus. It means to give up your right to be safe. You know, we're so focused on, I want to be safe. I want to be comfortable. I want God to protect me and protect my stuff. But the reality is God never called us to that. He called us to follow. And in some cases, that will mean giving up and facing things that are uncomfortable. Give up your right to get what you want. We all want what we want, but God says, no, what you want is not always what you need. We need to give up our sin. We need to start hating sin. Sin is real, and sin is an affront to God, and Jesus died on the cross because of it. And we need to hate sin. Stop being conformed to this world. Give up those things. We need to give up. We need to conform. We conform to the other ways and the enemy and the flesh and our other voices and other people's opinions, and we get confused. And we need to give up and surrender to Jesus. That's how we hear and understand God's will. And honestly, listen to this. That's where God's will starts. When you give your life totally to Him. It starts when you first of all give your life to Jesus by asking Jesus into your heart. But then it also continues as a follower of Christ. A full surrender. So we as Wesleyans, and the Bible talks about this entire sanctification, it's sanctifying ourselves. Saying not us sanctifying ourselves, but giving ourselves to Jesus. And God sanctifies us wholly. It's surrender. It's giving everything that we have to Jesus. And saying, here, I'm not my own anymore. Because in all honesty, we will never discover the will of God if we are taking this as an option. This is what we do sometimes, and I've done this. God, I want your will. But then when his will comes, we're like, okay, I don't know if I like that. Can you give me another will? And we pick and choose, don't we? That's not surrender. That still means you're in charge. And God's like, you will never discover my will if you're not about surrender. Because it starts there. It starts right there. When we give everything we have to him and say, I'm not going to choose. I'm not going to make the choices. Instead, I'm going to choose to follow you and trust your will. That's a hard place to be. I understand that. But you know what? There's great freedom in that. There's great joy in that. There's great love in that. There's great power in that. There's great hope in that. And it's exactly where Jesus wants us to be. So how do we hear from God? We need to give up. We also need to add to our lives. It's also about putting into our lives what is needed. Romans 12:2a says this, do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And you know I was going there. You knew this had to be a part of it. But I got to say it. We do that by putting things into us, and we do that by putting in the word. We need to give up our old thinking and replace our thinking. I know, I've said this 1,000 times, but we can't know truth unless we know truth. And the word of God is truth. I was thinking this about a week ago, and again, with all the things with COVID-19 and with the racism and the issues of Black Lives Matters and all of those things, and I just want to say racism is wrong. And I need to pray, and I needed to pray. Say, God, show me if I'm racist. Show me if I have a hint of that in my life. And I don't want to hear what racism is from everybody else. I want to know what you say about it, what you say in my heart. God had to take me to task about some of those things. So just don't just wipe it out because you may or may not agree with it. So I guess I am stamping on some toes here. But please, folks, we need to listen to the heart of God in all of this. But I was listening to all the noise, and it was a ton of noise. And I said, Lord, how do we know? And the Lord said simply, come to me. Let me guide you. Let me show you in my word. That doesn't mean we can't listen to the television. We can't read the internet. We can't do all this. Of course, I'm not saying that. But fundamentally, our truth needs to come from God and his word. And if we spend as much time in his word as we did on the TV and the internet, our lives would change, don't you think? And that's not just wishful thinking. Folks, that's truth. But it's so easy. And I do this, to pick up my phone, even while I'm watching TV, while I'm supposed to be with my family. You know what I mean? Being honest. And I'm not saying that's all wrong. I'm just saying, how much time do we spend in the Word, and how much time do we spend in all the other stuff? And we wonder why we're confused. We wonder why we don't know what we're supposed to do, and we wonder why we react, and we wonder why we think this and we think that, and we get angry about stuff that we shouldn't even be angry about, and we wonder why all these things are happening, because we are being conformed to the pattern of this world instead of being transformed by the renewing of our mind. You know, people may say the Word doesn't have all the answers. And it doesn't maybe have specific answers. You know where in the Bible you will see COVID-19. You will find issues about racism. Yes, you will. But it doesn't talk about COVID-19. But it gives us principles to live our lives by, doesn't it? It doesn't talk about politics, but it does talk about the principles of love and grace and mercy and forgiveness and following the peace of Christ, and let that rule. The Bible says, let the peace of Christ rule your heart. Not the peace of Dave, not the peace of you, not your peace, but God's peace. Let it rule your heart. Let that be the principle that you live by. And I love this passage of Scripture in 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 and 4. It says this, His divine power has given us everything we need, listen to this, for life and godliness. Not just for being in church and not just for spiritual things, but he says his divine power has given you everything you need for life. Everything you need for life. Think about that. He's given it all to you. He goes on to say, through our knowledge of him who called us by his glorious goodness, by his own glory and goodness, talking about Jesus. This really is about Jesus. Jesus has given us his very great and precious promises so that through them you may participate in the divine nature. You can be like God. You're not God, but you can participate in his divine nature. You can be a part of who he is and escape, listen to this, escape the corruption in the world caused by evil desires. You want to live above the fray? You want to live above the noise? Let Jesus be the focus of your life. Let his word be the focus of your life. Put the word in your heart. So how do we hear from God? We need to give up. We need to add to our lives by putting in the word and also by putting action based on faith. You know, for years, I had this kind of foolish view of life. If I study the word, which you need to, and you need to get into the word, I thought, boy, that's great. And I can know chapter and verse, and I can have a great debate with you about what's true and what's not true. But the Lord spoke to me a number of years ago. He said, Dave, it's not about just knowing. You got to do it. You got to walk in it. You got to obey it. And I know you're like, well, of course, Dave, we know that. But how many times do we listen to the word? How many times have I read a passage of Scripture? And maybe you've read a passage of Scripture, and you're like, wow, I need to do something about that. And you just kind of leave it on the shelf, and you walk, and nothing changes. And God's like, you really want to know the truth? Follow me. Do it. Let me show you that it works. I love John 7, verse 17 says this, if anyone chooses to do God's will, if you choose to do God's will, he will find out, you will find out whether my teaching comes from God or whether I speak on my own. In other words, Jesus is saying, listen, if you want to follow my will, you want to follow me, you want to know that my truth is true, just follow me, do it, obey it, do what I say. Because as you do, you will discover, wow, this really works. God really does love me. Forgiveness does work. Grace does work. Mercy does work. Self-control does work. And all the other principles of God's word. God says, this is how it works, so go for it. And you will see it works. He's not only trying to, you know, he's not going to go up there and try to convince you logically. If you do this, then I will do this. He's not going to get you to all your ducks in a row. Sometimes you got to step out in faith and just trust, even if you don't see it all. It's just trusting him. I remember a lot of years ago, Becca, I don't know if you remember this, but when we were kids, when they were kids, we before they went to school, we would always pray with them in a circle. And I think that kind of irritated them sometimes. Unless the bus was there, then we'd have to kind of send them out. But then we'd also read a little, you know, remember those little loaves of bread and they have verses in them? How many remember those? Yeah, I don't know, they're a daily bread. And so we'd take a verse out, and I remember one hit me. I remember the moment. Do you remember that, Becca? No, but do you remember us doing that? Okay, yeah. And just want to make sure I'm not making this up, okay? I know I wasn't. But this is truth, okay? And I remember picking one up one day. I don't know if I've ever shared this or not, but it was Ecclesiastes chapter 11, verse 4. It says this, whoever watches the wind will not plant, and whoever looks at the clouds will not reap. And what really hit me about that is that so often we're waiting for everything to line up perfectly, God, if you do this, if you do this, if you do this, if you do this, you, then I'll step out in faith. And God's like, you're just waiting. Sometimes you gotta plant, even if the weather's not perfect. And you gotta reap sometimes if the weather's not perfect. If you're just looking at the clouds all the time, waiting for the perfect moment will never come. The perfect moment is when God tells you to do it and step out in faith and truth and follow him. So how do we hear from God? We need to give up. We need to add to our lives by putting in the word, by putting action based on faith, and by putting in time. And not talking about prison. It's an issue of waiting. All other voices that we hear are about instant gratification. Even the voice of us wanting to respond to somebody who has offended us. Isn't it instant? Wow! Is that scary? I'm sorry. Just to wake some of you up, I guess. Because really, honestly, isn't that what we want to do? Sorry about that. I hope I didn't give you a heart attack. That's awesome. Did I scare Albert? Sorry, Albert. Where was it? Oh, yeah. Because we want to react, right? We want to instantaneously respond because that's what our emotions tell us to do. And even in so many other things, we panic, we do this and we do that and we do that. But God's never about hurry. God's about time. Trusting over the long haul. I hate the word patience. That means in some scriptures it says long suffering. Nobody likes to long suffer. I mean, I've said this before. I'm a Prime member on Amazon, and I want it the next day. And when it doesn't, I get a little perturbed because I say, I'm paying for this. But we all want things instantly, don't we? We want it quickly. We don't want to wait in line. I mean, how many of you have had to wait in line at the dollar store recently? How many of you have chosen not to wait in line because the line seems too long? Right? I mean, it's ridiculous, right? Because we like things instantly. But God is really not about instantaneous stuff. He's about waiting. Because in the waiting, that's where we grow. That's where we learn to trust. That's where we learn to follow. That's where we learn to see that the results will come. And God is saying, wait on me. Trust me. In Romans 12, the last part of that verse is then you will be able to test. You will test it. And you will see it works and approve, listen to this, what God's will is. His good, pleasing, and perfect will. As you give up, as you add those things to your life, you will find his good, pleasing, and perfect will. In this crazy world, we need to find the voice of God. So who are we listening to? Or better yet, let me make this very personal. Whose voice are you listening to? Whose voice are you listening to? It doesn't mean that you can't learn from other people's voices. It may be truth, but do we take it to God and we filter it through his word and do we filter it through prayer and say, God, is this what you want? Is this truth? Is this what I need to do? Is this how I need to respond? Because I'm not talking about, you know, like, and for different people, there may be different, please understand this, not different truths, but different ways of dealing with it. But here's the thing. Do we even seek God? Are we even asking? Whose voice are you listening to? Let's pray. Lord, this has been a really convicting message for me. And you know the stuff you've been dealing with me even in this past week as I've gone over this thing in my head. Because I don't want it to be about me just listening and never doing. But help me to listen and do in those areas of my life that you're calling me to change in. Those areas of my life where you're trying to humble me in. Those areas of my life where I just need to listen to your voice and only your voice. So Lord, I don't know where people are today. I don't know how you're speaking to people's hearts. But God, if there's some things that people need to respond to, even as we sing this last song, if there's some people who need to come and pray here at the front, I know we got to do it socially distanced and all of that, but God, if they need to pray about it, let them just come. Let them come and just seek you. If it's an issue of maybe giving their heart to you for the first time because they want to hear your voice, or maybe it's an issue of surrender, where God, you come and you sanctify them wholly. You change their life forever. And there's no more battles in the sense that they're just giving up. They're just finally surrendering everything to you. Because they want to follow the truth totally in their life. Maybe there's issues where they have listened to wrong information and they've responded and they've had bitterness and anger in their heart and there's something you're dealing with them on. Holy Spirit, speak. And help us to listen to your voice. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Whose voice are you listening to today? Stand with us in praise.
Thank you.
God is so good. Praise the Lord that we serve someone who knows us, who knows our every feeling. And so today you are sent knowing fully and confidently that whatever your circumstances, whatever you're walking through, God is with you, He is for you, and He is leading you. You are sent this morning. We are going to again continue to participate in sending from the back row out. And I would just invite you today, we're going to feel pulled back into this song. So we're going to go back and we're going to do How He Loves. And if you feel like you'd like to stay and worship with us, again, you are dismissed, you are sent. Please do not feel led. But we have altars up front. You would need to go to the ends of the altars to give 6 feet. Yeah, we're just going to go back into this song. Feel free to make your way out, make your way to the front. If you would like prayer, Pastor Dave is available. And if there are too many people, we can certainly go. Thank you.